It's another episode of A Gamer's Guide to Feminism. This time we're looking at the second wave. Trying to capture the whole of the second wave of feminism in a YouTube video is impossible. The second wave of feminism included an explosive amount of social change and was tied into a much broader period of culture war, unlike anything seen since maybe the Industrial Revolution. Second wave feminism produced legislation such as Title VII, Title IX, Title X, and the Equal Pay Act. One of the Equal Pay Acts, anyway. It was a period of Supreme Court decisions like Griswold versus Connecticut guaranteeing rights for married couples to use birth control, Eisenstadt versus Baird that gave unmarried couples the same protections, Reed versus Reed prohibited gender discrimination in estate settlements, and the infamous Roe versus Wade, which granted women elective abortion rights. It saw women gain protections against being fired for being pregnant. It saw marital rape become a crime. No-fault divorce became possible. Sex before marriage became more accepted, in part thanks to the birth control pill. We first heard the terms sexual harassment and male gaze during the second wave, and rape crisis centers began opening up. Women were even given equal status on juries, and women could seek legal protections against physically abusive partners. The first Take Back the Night March was held in response to the murder of a female microbiologist who had been walking home alone at night. Women were allowed to attend military academies, were integrated into scientific bodies like NASA. Some churches allowed women to be ordained as ministers, and there was a permanent increase in activity by female authors and academics. And Margaret Thatcher became Britain's first female prime minister. Gloria Steinem's Playboy Bunny expose, Robin Morgan's protest of the Miss America pageant, and Billie Jean King's victory at the Battle of the Sexes tennis match, Helen Redding's I Am Woman, and Dell Williams founding the first woman-owned sex toy business in America. All of this helped change the dialogue surrounding women in the West and permanently impacted what the free world considered appropriate behavior for women. In other parts of the world, there was also change. Nawal el-Saadawi, now dubbed the Simone de Beauvoir of the Arab world, published Women and Sex, which took on patriarchal political and theological authorities in Egypt. Japan adopted equal employment opportunity legislation, and Turkey and Israel saw their own second wave movements during the 1980s. During this period in history, the world was going through huge change and upheaval in ways beyond women's rights. Student protests, the African American civil rights movement, the anti-war movement, and the backlash to the second anti-communist Red Scare all impacted the form and character of the feminist movement because none of these causes existed in a vacuum. The connections to the anti-war movement led to the false assumption that for something to be feminist, it must also be pacifist. The historical links between feminism and communism helped fuel the rise of anti-feminism as a form of anti-communist sentiment. And the divisions between black civil rights and women's rights movements saw many African-American women prioritize civil rights involving race, which had the side effect of seeing fewer of their unique issues incorporated into second wave feminism's agenda. Some employment initiatives for women also stalled because prominent women's groups leaders saw the poverty and unemployment of black men as a more pressing issue. Alongside these numerous and notable successes, second wave feminism had some high-profile defeats. President Richard Nixon vetoed the Comprehensive Child Development Bill of 1972 because he thought it was too communist, and the ratification of the Equal Rights Amendment fell short by just 3 states. The opposition to the ERA by some women included arguments that sound eerily familiar today. Fears of men attending women's only colleges and unisex bathrooms. The ERA failed in part because it violated some women's safe spaces. But second wave feminism, like any political movement, was also riven with internal divisions, notably around sexuality. Lesbians within feminism were branded the Lavender Menace, which to me sounds like a My Little Pony, but whatever. Some straight feminists were concerned that the mannish and man-hating stereotypes associated with lesbian feminists were getting in the way of serious political change. Some lesbian feminists also tended to be anti-pornography because at the time, porn was made primarily by men for men. I know, a world without an abundance of lesbian porn is a strange thing to contemplate today. The theories developed by lesbian feminists are dense, but many are essentially accepted now. The idea that media made by someone other than a straight man for an audience other than a straight man has a place That's pretty accepted now. In fact, a favorite concept of second wave feminism, the male gaze, has been significantly undermined by queer media. We can no longer assume that mass media properties are presumed to be for a straight male audience, thanks to the presence of feminist TV shows, tons of gay porn made for gay people, cartwheeling naked men in video games, and BioWare. Aw, man, now I'm imagining Elcor porn. Horrified. That would be weird. Other ideas no longer apply. The idea that pornography inherently promotes a violent male view of sexuality is not generally accepted by the modern adult industry. Although the argument that a proliferation of porn is a backlash against feminism might have some truth to it, based on some of the spam I get on Twitter. And that was exactly the thing that ended the second wave of feminism. Before it broke the internet, porn broke feminism. The most prominent voice on the anti-pornography side was Andrea Dworkin, and I'm gonna give Dworkin's theories their own video because they had a profound effect on the criticisms against video games. But essentially, Dworkin thought all expressions of male sexuality were aggressive and encouraged violence against women. She'd apparently never spent much time with science fiction nerds, or most of my YouTube commenters, who are probably science fiction nerds and laughed at the Elcor porn joke. On the pro-sex side were feminists who believed that the patriarchy they were fighting against didn't just hurt women. It hurt all people because it encouraged censorship and oppression of sexuality. Second wave pro-sex feminists opposed obscenity laws and other measures that restricted expressions of sexuality. They examined past historical sexual moral panics and engaged in intense critiques of feminism itself. Some pro-sex feminists like Gail Rubin argued for separating scholarship on sexuality from feminism because sexual preference is distinct from gender. Some second wave pro-sex feminists believed in the idea of sexual minorities, for example, people who practice sadomasochism. This clashed with the anti-porn feminists who believed that healthy sexuality can only exist between partners of equal power. BDSM, of course, deliberately imbalances the power exchange in sex for pleasure. When these two factions clashed, things got really ugly. Since obscenity laws have gradually loosened, people are allowed to talk about sex, masturbation, and menstruation in public, and the porn business is booming, the pro-sex feminists ultimately won the sex wars. However, the nasty dogmatic tactics that formed because the two sides of the conflict utterly loathed each other has persisted in the joyless, censorious type of feminism that most gamers are familiar with today. The cycle went something like this. Because the anti-porn feminists were more in line with patriarchal dogmas surrounding modesty, the suppression of sex and women as victims, anti-porn feminists controlled the mainstream dialogue regarding feminism. When pro-sex feminists tried to hold their own conferences to discuss their positions, anti-porn feminists complained that they'd been excluded and subject to a process now known as no platforming. Pro-sex feminists then argued that the inclusion of anti-porn feminists in their conferences would cause the conferences to be overrun by the anti-porn viewpoint, which would have defeated the whole purpose of their existence. So the anti-porn faction protested the pro-sex conferences, and pro-sex conferences started losing their funding for being too controversial. If you think this sounds a lot like what's happening in the games industry these days, you'd be right. I think the important thing for gamers to take away from this brief examination of second wave feminism is that all feminists are not inherently against depictions of female nudity and sex, even violent or deviant sex. And despite the respect, in hindsight, for second wave feminists, many people at the time thought feminism was helping to destroy democracy, capitalism, and was going to feminize men. An anti-feminist movement rose up, including some women, who insisted that the West didn't need feminism, even at a time when women were not legally empowered to refuse sex to their husbands, keep a job when they got pregnant, or practice birth control. Before Title IX, women were barred from attending America's top schools, but some women didn't think we needed feminism. Before Title X, low-income people had no access to family planning or preventative health services in America, meaning that rape of poor women was more likely to result in pregnancy and access to abortion was extremely curtailed. But some women didn't think we needed feminism. So if you're one of those people who think we don't need feminism now, ask yourself, are you absolutely sure? Just because some sex-negative feminists engage in abusive and manipulative tactics doesn't mean that all feminism is bad or that there isn't still work to be done. There are still serious issues regarding children of single mothers being caught in poverty traps, survivors of rape in marginalized communities not seeking help from the police because they just don't trust the cops, and sex workers not being able to report sex crimes without the risk of being charged themselves. And that's just things going on in North America. Within gaming, we're seeing a replication of what happened during the feminist sex wars. The anti-sex feminists have taken over the mainstream discourse, but that doesn't mean they're the real feminists, nor that their victory is assured. They lost on rock and roll, they lost on porn, they lost on hip-hop music, and I believe they'll eventually lose regarding video games, because free speech protections are too central to progressive thought to give up those rights to protect women from naughty images. In the meantime, however, they're attempting to win via shame tactics because they have no legal recourse. Games are protected speech, and therefore, no developer can be forced to make their digital women cover up. But, like porn before it, anti-sex feminists are working to make games with sex and nudity prohibitively difficult to purchase. On the bright side, we saw how well that worked regarding porn. That is to say, it didn't work at all. It's important to examine sexual politics, sexual dynamics, and depictions of men and women in games. But that isn't the same as removing certain types of men and women from games. There's a lot of noise right now distracting us from the core issues of this debate, but this has all happened before, and I'm giving you guys this information in the hopes that we can finally start seeking a resolution together. Gaming is amazing because of the amount of choice the gamer has over their personal experience. And this specialization of experience should thrill feminists. And it does thrill some feminists, like me. And all types of women, including trans women, advocated for freedom of sexual expression during the second wave of feminism. But like I said, we're still functioning under a feminist paradigm strongly influenced by the anti-porn, anti-sex for pleasure ideas of Andrea Dworkin. And I'll examine why that lure is so strong in the next video.